Okay, thanks very much, and please excuse my croaky voice. I'll do my best. So, a lot of what... Ooh. Do we want to get rid of that?
No,
it'll go away. Okay. So, a lot of what I'm going to say is similar to what Matt just said. Our program in institutional memberships has existed since the beginning of PLOS in 2003. Well, the beginning as a publisher. It's fairly straightforward. It's not as varied as Matt's BMC program. We have about 150 members now internationally, mostly in Europe and North America, and it's an annual membership. So the kinds of benefits that the institutional members get, and I should say largely this has been driven not so much by us, but by the institutions themselves. When we started in 2003, I don't think we really were planning to launch an institutional membership, but there was clearly a thirst for that within the institutional, within institutions and librarians and so on. They wanted this kind of association with PLOS, which was fantastic. But it's a fairly straightforward thing. So there's just a 10% publication discount for the members of that institution. So it's a small extra incentive for those researchers to publish with PLOS. We provide reports on publishing activity. There's an e-newsletter. But I think it's more about the relationship building. This stuff to do with OA support. So we often get members who come to us and they're running a small meeting or something like that, and they'd like to see whether it's possible that PLOS could provide a speaker or something. So we help with that. We help to provide resources and promotional materials that help to promote open access. And we also make connections between institutions and other types of organisations, like Spark, if they want to get involved in a particular conversation, or they're trying to figure out what to do about Open Access Week or something like that. So there's a lot of that goes on, and then there's this final thing, that it provides the institution with this very public, demonstrable support of open access, and a lot of institutions want to do that, and it's fantastic that they do. And I think that's where most of the benefits really lie. The way we work it out is fairly straightforward. We basically just use the volume of how much did this institution publish with us last year, how many articles did they submit, and so on. And like Matt and Hindawi as well, we're seeing a lot of growth, so we build in a sort of a growth factor, and then project roughly how much publishing volume is likely to be the following year. And that allows us to calculate the overall total discount, and then we charge a fee that basically sort of more or less covers that discount. So it's a kind of cost neutral arrangement, both from our point of view and from the library's point of view as well. So the money that we lose in the discounts we recover from the institutional membership fee, and similarly the institution gains from the discounts, but then pays us the fee. So financially it's more or less neutral. The process for authors is very simple. So during the submission process, they're asked, you can't see this, but they're asked if they are a member of an institution that has one of these discounts, and in this case, York University Canada is identified, and so the fee is reduced, and so the authors are just told that. As I said, the main benefits to PLOS and to open access more broadly, I think, is really about relationship building between us and institutions and librarians. It provides us with, helps us support our advocacy efforts. So the person who runs the institutional membership program, Donna Rakubo, whom some of you might have come across, is also the person who really coordinates advocacy stuff at PLOS. So it helps us from that point of view. It gives us more insights into obviously the issues that affect academics and librarians, with publishing issues from their point of view. And of course, it provides a way, as I've said, for us to help promote PLOS and to help promote open access within the institution by providing materials and so on. And another thing that we're seeing as well is we're getting involved in conversations about, so you're an institutional member, but the institution might be interested in taking that a stage further. And what we've already heard about from Chuck is this idea of a central fund. And so increasingly, we're getting involved in conversations about how, for example, a membership of PLOS might evolve into a more general policy to support open access through a central fund, which is great to see. And then the other thing that's happened more recently on a very small scale is this idea of direct billing. which I guess is similar to one of Matt's, what Matt talked about. And really, again, this was driven by people that came to us. So Max Planck were one of the people that came to us, and they wanted to basically for us to bill them directly. It started in 2007. We only have three organizations that do this. We send a monthly statement. They then send back an approval that the authors really are, you know, a member or of their institution, or they're funded by them, and then we send an invoice. So it has all the, it works in the same way as what Matt talked about. Again, during the submission process, the authors just asked whether they're associated or affiliated with any of these institutions, so we know not to bill them. Is direct billing a good idea? And some of these points have already been made. You know, I think the thing that I feel not so you know, enthusiastic about this idea of direct billing is because it does begin to insulate authors from the cost of publishing. And I really like, you know, the model that Matt talked about at the end, where it's kind of a more shared approach or discounts or Chuck's approach of it being a safety net, you know. So you're directing the funds in that way in a kind of an intelligent and creative way. And so I'm not a big fan of direct billing as a kind of an overall solution for this. And you know, there is the potential as well to reduce freedom in terms of where to publish. On the other hand, it does reduce the complexity of the billing process, so that's a good thing. And it obviously enables institutions to report track their publishing activity very accurately. And finally, of course, it does help authors who don't have access to funds. But I think there are other ways of doing that, as we've heard. So that's pretty much all I wanted to say. So, hand over to Paul.